السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah سبحانه وتعالى, most gracious, most merciful. الحمد لله. All praise is indeed due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that He has bestowed upon us. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his entire household. Do you know the meaning of household? His whole family, all of them, his wives, as well as his children and his grandchildren and every member of his family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And we send blessings as well to all the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, starting with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. His name was Abdullah ibn Uthman, and Uthman was his father. His father was also known as Abu Quhafa, so that is why they called him Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa radiallahu anhu. We call him Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. That is the common name, but it's important for you to know that his actual name is Abdullah ibn Uthman radiallahu anhu. Thereafter Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. All the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are champions, they are superheroes, they are people who were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we ask Allah to make us His companions in the Akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us His companions in the Akhirah. Allahumma la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal alimul hakim. Allahumma 'allimna ma yanfa'una wanfa'na bima 'allamtana. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa' wa min 'aynin la tadma' wa min qalbin la yakhsha' wa min batnin la yashba' wa min du'a'in la yusma'. Indeed, we have no knowledge besides that which Allah has granted us. We ask Allah to benefit us from the knowledge He has granted us and to grant us beneficial knowledge and to be able to put it into practice and to convey it to others. That is what is of ultimate importance. My brothers and sisters in Kumasi in Ghana, I thank Allah to give me the opportunity to visit you here to witness the warmth and the rich history of Islam in your part of the world. Very rich history. It is important that we preserve this beautiful history. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you goodness and growth. May He grant you positive growth, and may He make your offspring steadfast on the deen up to the end of time. Ameen. Once again, my brothers and sisters, there was a young boy just before I got up here to deliver my talk who imitated word for word a lecture of mine. So now there is no point for me to speak. Brothers, I think the sound was right. We are going too high and we are spoiling it. We can go back to where it was when I started. Sorry, I am a person, I am just your brother. You can excuse me. I don't mind saying things. I don't want to hold it in my heart up to the end, and then I go away and I say, in Kumasi, the sound was not good. I'd rather drop the sound a little bit than to make it such that we cannot even hear each other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me, and may He forgive us all. Jazakallah khair. Thank you. You see, it made a difference. Imagine if I was quiet, I would actually end my talk halfway. I would not be myself. I would go away almost half crying, thinking to myself that I should have said something. And this is why you just need to be genuine. If you are a person, just be what you are. That's it. You don't need to show something that you are not. I arrived in Ghana, and guess what happened? My bags did not come. Subhanallah. So I came in without my clothing. Well, obviously I was wearing some clothing, mashallah. But I came in without my bag, the clothing was gone, my robes were gone, everything was gone, my headgear is gone, everything was not there, and the bag is lost without trace. Nobody can tell me where that bag is. But I say, Alhamdulillah. If I did not tell you, you would not know, right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. The reason I make mention of it is when you come to people who warmly welcome you, when you come to people who are of hearts that are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, then forget about what happened during the journey. You are just a happy man, alhamdulillah. May Allah keep us happy. And may we not become upset for small material items of this world. Sometimes we get angry because of material things of this world. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, those material items, Allah knows sometimes that it was better for you to lose something. Sometimes when you lose your mobile phone and you don't have it anymore, maybe there is someone on that phone Allah does not want you to communicate with. So you lost the number. Because you had a haram relationship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved you enough to make you lose your phone. Just thank Allah. Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. Today I want to talk about peace. And I want to talk about a certain angle of peace. You know, when we speak about peace, many people think that we are going to talk about the physical peace. Yes, we have discussed that topic. I've been speaking about it. I touched on it when I was in Kenya last week, when I was in Nigeria the previous week. I touched on it yesterday when I was in Accra as well. Today I want to touch on another angle of peace. The most important peace is the inner peace. That peace which I need inside myself. No matter what happens, I am happy. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ. Amazing are the affairs of a true believer. For indeed all the affairs of a true believer are good for him. They are good. When goodness comes in his direction, he thanks Allah. He is grateful. So that is good for him. He will see growth. لَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. Allah says, if you are going to show gratitude, then indeed, if you are going to show gratitude, indeed I will grant you increase. You will have more and more. But if you are going to be ungrateful, Allah says, remember my punishment is very, very severe. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who are grateful. And may He protect us from being from amongst those who show ingratitude. So one might ask, how does a person show ingratitude? How am I ungrateful? How can I be ungrateful? Allah has given me so much. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, ingratitude and ungratefulness is when you turn away from Allah Himself. The one who gave you everything you have. You don't want to fulfill prayer for Him. You want to worship that which is besides Allah or something with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me give you this beautiful example which will be the theme of my lecture today. Luqman, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. Luqman, I'm sure we've heard that name, right? There is a surah, an entire surah in the Quran named after this man who was Luqman. And Allah says, Subhanallah, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنِشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ وَمَنْ يَشْكُرْ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ حَمِيدٌ. Verse number 12 of Surah Luqman. Allah says, and remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon Luqman wisdom. He was known as Al-Hakim, the wise. Remember when Allah bestowed upon Luqman the wisdom. I want to stop there for a minute because, mashallah, when I got here, I asked Brother Saifullah, how much time do I have? He said, unlimited. Which means I can finish, inshallah, with salah. Is that correct? I can finish with the next salah because the word unlimited is restricted to what Allah has stopped us by. Isn't it? If the adhan goes off, we have to stop. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. Luqman was wise. Allah mentions his name in the Quran because Allah gave him wisdom. It shows us that wisdom is something very high. It is over and above knowledge. Some people have a lot of knowledge, but they don't have wisdom. So you know too much information, but you don't know how to relay it to the people. Allah says, وَمَن يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوتِيَ خَيْرًا. Whoever has been granted wisdom has been granted goodness, tremendous goodness, a lot of goodness, abundance in goodness. My brothers and sisters, when you learn something, become humble. become down to earth. Learn to interact with people. Learn to relate to them. Learn to greet them. Learn to smile with them. Learn to interact in a way that your knowledge becomes beneficial to them. Because wallahi, if you are arrogant, nobody wants to take your knowledge from you. They will throw you on one side because of your arrogance. How many of us, we learn from those who don't know too much, but they know a little bit. Their character outshines the character of others, so they are pleasant to interact with, so we learn from them. Am I right? Subhanallah. So my brothers and sisters, as you learn, the difference between the true knowledge of the deen and the knowledge that is besides that of the deen, the knowledge of the deen comes with humbleness, humility, softness. When you are an alim, you are a person who knows, your character is soft. What is the evidence of it? Allah says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was more knowledgeable than anyone who existed, Allah says,
فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ فَاعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ.
Subhanallah, Allah says, it is only by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are lenient towards them. It's only by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are lenient towards them. If you were harsh and hard-hearted, they would have dispersed from around you. They would not be around you. They would run away. They would go away. That is the evidence. When we speak about deen, the knowledge of the deen makes you soft. Soft in what way? Towards people. Soft towards people. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu to Yemen in order to call the Christians to Islam, do you know what he says? Firstly, he told Mu'adh ibn Jabal on another occasion, Ya Mu'adh, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ فَادْعُوهُمْ إِلَىٰ شَهَادَةِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Oh Mu'adh ibn Jabal, you are going to go to a nation of people of the book, the Christians. You need to call them in a beautiful way towards worshipping Allah alone, to witness, to bear witness that Allah is one, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. So in the other narration, he tells the two of them, when he is giving them the farewell advice, he says, Bashira wala tunafira. The two of you are going. I want you to give good news. I don't want you to give bad news. Don't chase people away. Don't give bad news where you doom the people. My brothers and sisters, if every day I tell you, you are going to burn in the fire, you are going to burn in the fire, you will be burning in the fire, Naru Jahannam is waiting for you. If you head to the right, you will see the fire. If you go to the left, you will see the fire. If you look this way, you will see the fire. You are going to burn, you are doomed, you are cursed, etc. What will happen? The people will become depressed. They will be depressed. I've seen young people whom, when they hear only about the fire every single day, what happens to them? They start thinking, you know what? I'm already going to the fire. So what's the point? I'd rather now commit adultery. I'd rather steal. I'd rather gamble. Do as much as I want, because as it is, my destination is Jahannam. Astaghfirullah. But rather than that, give them good news. The deen is based on mercy. When Allah opens Surah Al-Fatiha, He opens it with mercy. When you want to start reading the Quran, you start off with the mercy of Allah. You say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Bismillah, in the name of Allah. He chose the qualities He wants to be mentioned when you are starting off with His name. He did not choose another quality. He didn't say in the name of Allah who is going to punish and throw the people into the fire. Did he say that? No. He said in the name of Allah who is forgiving, most merciful. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. The difference between the two is Ar-Rahim is a special mercy for the believers. And Ar-Rahman is a mercy for everyone, believers and not believers also. Allah has mercy. It is the mercy of Allah that the sky has not crashed down to the earth and destroyed us. It is the mercy of Allah that the earth is carrying us. Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. When we start Surah Al-Fatiha, we say,
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim.
Look at the beauty of it. All praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Subhanallah. These are the first qualities Allah chose to tell us. Yes, we will also remind people of the punishment because it is in the Quran. It is in Revelation, definitely. But when we remind people of the punishment, make sure that you don't allow them to feel that they are doomed, but rather they should understand and realize that Allah is waiting for them.
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ
Say, O my worshippers who have transgressed against themselves, tell them that Allah's mercy encompasses everything. Allah will forgive them, will forgive every single sin. Tell them not to lose hope in my mercy. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Do not become from among those who despair regarding the mercy of Allah. Allah is most merciful. No matter what you have done, He will forgive you. But seek the forgiveness. No matter what you have done, He will grant you Jannah. But work towards Jannah. I want Jannah, but I'm walking towards Jahannam. I want to go to Kumasi, but my flight is heading towards Accra. Where am I going to go? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May He grant us goodness. Try your best. Wherever you have faltered, seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is how you will attain peace inside you. Many people today, they are not at peace. They are searching for peace. They are hunting for happiness. But they are hunting for happiness in that which is going to come to an end. For example, money. Money, wealth, material items. Will that bring you happiness? It can never bring you true happiness. The evidence of it is, we have seen wealthy, wealthy, wealthy people. They cannot sleep without a pill. Do you know that? They need to pop some pills before they sleep. Sleeping pills. Whereas there are some who barely have some money, but when they sleep, the wife writes a letter to us. This man is snoring so loud. Allahu Akbar. This man is snoring so loud. And nowadays the husband writes a letter. My wife is snoring. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. The point being raised is, the sound sleep is never connected to how much money you have. Never. The sound sleep is connected to the condition of your heart by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the blessing He has bestowed upon you. You are not worried at all, subhanallah. You are content, you are happy. That is the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People are searching for happiness in so many other things. Do you know what? In many countries, you find that the women are searching for happiness in makeup. Allahu Akbar. It's a reality. They will stand in front of the mirror. They are not happy with what Allah gave them. Yet Allah gave them the best. So they start saying, I need to cover my face. I need to look like someone else. I need my nose to be long. I need this to be this way. I need my eyes to look like a kitten. I need, for example, my legs to look like plastic. And so on. Why? There are women who put makeup on their knees because they want their knees to look somehow a little bit different than they are. That is ridiculous. Did you know that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Islam is the only religion on earth that tells you, we want you to dress in a way that ensures that people will judge you based on your dedication, your service, your character, your conduct and your deen, not on your appearance, your complexion, your color, your looks. Never. That's why Islam says cover yourself. When you don't cover your hair, you are worried about what people will say regarding the hair that Allah has given me. How? You will never achieve peace. We are talking about peace. You will go for this dreads and you will go for that extension, and you will go for the other plaits, and you will go for those braids, and you will continue going and spending all your money on your hair. All your money on your hair. To show who? To show those who are not allowed to touch it. Those who are not allowed to come near. Those who will just say, wow. When I was a kid, they used to tell us that the dogs say, bow wow. Why do you want people to say, wow? When you know it's not going to help. The day your hair is not according to the standard of some other person who's next to you, they won't look at you anymore. They look at the new style from Brazil. Subhanallah. May Allah forgive us. It's happening in society. Be happy with the decree of Allah. Allah says, you need to just don the hijab. That's it. You need to don the hijab. Nobody will judge you based on your hair. Nobody will judge you based on how short or tall or dark or light you are, etc. Or whether your nose is this way or that way or whatever else. They will judge you based on your dedication, your character, your conduct, your deen. This is why when it comes to marriage, the Prophet ﷺ makes it clear. You want peace? Do you want peace in the future? You need to think about who you are going to marry. The hadith speaks about إذا أتاكم من ترضون دينه وخلقه فزوجوه إلا تفعلوه تكن فتنة في الأرض وفساد عريض. If someone comes with a proposal, and this address is to the awliya al-umur of the females, this address is to the guardians of the females. If someone comes to you with a proposal and his level of deen is satisfactory, his level of character is satisfactory, let him get married. Don't say no for no reason. Obviously, the girl needs to say yes. If the girl is not interested, you are not allowed to force her. Remember that. In Islam, it is haram to force your daughter to marry someone she does not want to marry. Remember that. Did you hear what I said? I'm repeating it because people don't realize. In Islam, it is haram to force your daughter to marry someone whom she does not want to marry. That daughter belongs to Allah before she belongs to you. So you cannot force her. But you need to understand, if she is happy, someone has come with a proposal and the man's deen is okay, the man's, subhanallah, his character is okay, you are not allowed to say, you are too dark in complexion for my daughter, she is fair. You are not allowed to say, you belong to that tribe, I belong to this tribe. No. You are not allowed to say you come from the north, I come from the south. No. You look at the deen and the akhlaq. That is how you will achieve peace. That man will be the father of your grandchildren, subhanallah. That man is going to be your husband, subhanallah. That woman is going to be your wife. They are going to look after your children. If you went after someone who had 12-inch heels, who couldn't even walk on their tiptoes just because they had a skirt, they showed their behind and they showed their breasts and they showed everything to do with their legs and nudity, etc., etc. If that was the reason you chose, I want to let you know, it's Allah's plan that that will begin to diminish and disperse. As time passes, it's gone. It's gone. You marry for beauty alone, beauty goes away. I am not saying don't look at the beauty. But I am saying it is not a primary point of decision making. Remember that. You look at someone, you might want to compromise a little bit when it comes to looks, when it comes to wealth, you compromise a little bit. Deen and akhlaq, I don't compromise. You don't read salah, that's it. You are not fit to be the father of my children. You are not there for salatul fajr, you are not fit to be the father of my children. Because I want my children really and truly to grow up seeing the father fulfill the salah before he even instructs them. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, if you choose a spouse, say a wife, who is covered correctly, properly, your children, 2 years old, 3 years old, your daughter will want to dress like her mother. Without anyone saying anything, she will fight to wear clothing just like the mother. Whereas if the mother wears nothing, the child will move around naked. It's a reality. So you want peace in your future generations, choose correctly your spouse. Choose correctly your spouse. I see the older people are just looking at me, I've already made the mistake, what can I do now? Subhanallah. What can I do now? Now we can turn back to Allah. We can always make tawbah. We can go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
If we have made mistakes, there's no harm. Allah always says, it's never too late. You are still breathing. You are alive. So go back to Allah. Ask Allah's forgiveness. Seek His forgiveness. Mend your ways. Your children can still improve. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. You want peace? You need peace in your home. You want peace in your home? You need to choose the spouse correctly. You need to be a father who's the role model of your children. Wallahi. You want your child to forget about sin? You need to stop adultery, firstly. You need to stop zina, firstly, to begin with. You need to stop gambling and drinking and drugs and smoking and everything else. Then you can expect your children, inshallah, to be guided in a similar way. How can we expect our children to live in peace when we are living in pieces? How? Everything is broken. Wife is fighting with husband because he's having an affair, and you want your daughter to be straight. Would you be happy? When the Prophet ﷺ was confronted by one young man who said, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ, I have the urge of committing adultery. I want to commit zina. You know what? They were open people. Eh? They knew they could communicate with him. Imagine how many of our ulama, can someone come up to him and say, Sheikh, I want to commit zina. What would happen? Sheikh would say, Astaghfirullah, a'udhu billah, get out. Shaitan al-rajim, this is the shaitan. How? The Prophet ﷺ says, listen. Would you like it for your mother? He said, no. Would you like it for your sister? He said, no. Would you like it for a daughter of yours? No. Would you like it for your aunt? No. Well, all the women out there, they are somebody's daughters, somebody's aunts, somebody's mothers, etc., etc. He thought for a moment, he said, Wallahi, I don't want to commit it at all. Never, ever again. No. Hikmah, wisdom, spoke to him. He convinced him in one small moment to say, look, whoever you are committing adultery with is somebody's daughter. You want someone, take them with goodness in the name of Allah. Protect them, give them honor. Islam teaches you not to use and abuse the women in a way that there is no connection between you and them. You use them, astaghfirullah, you have done whatever you wanted to, and goodbye. Now you don't know them. Goodbye. That's it. Islam says, if you want, yes, you need to be honest, you need to be honorable, you need to do it in a halal way, permissible way. Allah made it easy. How long does it take to do nikah? I don't think more than 35 seconds. The last time I timed it, it was a few seconds, subhanallah. Why not? May Allah help us attain peace in our homes. Remember, as I said, be correct role models for your children. Oh my dear sister, be a role model for your children. And Allah will bless you. Let's move on. So Luqman alayhi salam is being mentioned because he was wise. Because Allah gave him wisdom. And part of the wisdom is gratitude. Those who are wise, they show gratitude. When you do good to me, I thank you. The minimum I say is Jazakumullahu khairan. May Allah reward you. You did good to me. I am wise to thank you. When I thank you correctly, you will inshallah next time be even better by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine a beggar, someone gives him $1, $2, $5, and he just walks away. That is one beggar. But if there is another beggar, you give him $1 and he says, sir, I appreciate it. May God bless you, etc., etc. He gives you a lot of prayers. He looks, thank you so much. You have made my day. Maybe there is a tear in his eyes. What will happen? Almost immediately, you might take out $5 and put more. Almost immediately. Why? Because he's showing you gratitude. Gratitude. What about Allah? Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. You cannot get up for Salatul Fajr, my brothers, my sisters, and he gave you your life. You cannot fulfill your salah. You cannot dress appropriately when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed you with everything you have. You are breathing, you are eating, you are drinking, you are seeing. Subhanallah. Your eyes are seeing so clearly. Amazing. And you cannot thank Allah. You did not read the Quran. 1 month has passed. The last time you read the Quran was in Ramadan. Ramadan, because they say Shahrul Quran, it does not mean it's the only month where Quran needs to be read. No. You want to show gratitude to Allah, show it. It is part of wisdom. So Allah says, whoever is ungrateful, Allah doesn't need you. Allah is independent. When you say Alhamdulillahi ala kulli hal, did you help Allah? No, you help yourself. When you said, I'm getting up early for Salatul Fajr, and you got up, did you help Allah? No. Allah says, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالَكُمْ. If you are going to turn away, simple, we will replace you with others, and they will not be like you. They will be better than you. So don't think if I am not at Fajr, there will be no one at Fajr. The masjid is full, but you are missing. Don't think if I am not at Jum'ah, it's okay. You won't be there, everyone else is there. Don't think if I do not put on the hijab, it's okay. There are so many others putting on the hijab as a result of you taking it out. Remember that. Whenever I visit countries in Africa, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I see people in the West abandoning the hijab. For everyone in the West who abandons their hijab, there are 10 in Africa who wear the hijab. So thank Allah. We won't abandon it. No way. Your identity is being snatched away from you. Don't let it go. Hold on to it. That is your Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. May He grant us goodness and ease to fulfill what He has asked us to fulfill. So Luqman alayhi salam, Allah says he was wise. He was thankful. Whoever is thankful, definitely it is for himself. And whoever is ungrateful, Allah does not need him at all. So, because Allah makes mention of this man being very wise, Allah now talks about what he said. What he said. If I tell you this man is very intelligent, you want to hear from him, right? How is he intelligent? Maybe he can share some intelligence with us. So Allah makes it clear that Luqman was a wise man. So please share some wisdom with us. Before we ask that question, Allah already says, وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. I start off by saying, this Luqman alayhi salam, or Luqman, may Allah be pleased with him. What happened? Allah says, remember the time when he was guiding his son, when he was lecturing his son, when he was giving some words of guidance to his son, al-maw'idha, words of guidance, a speech of goodness to his son. Stop. What do I learn from this? The relationship between father and son is so good that father can say anything to son in a beautiful way. How many of us have relationships with our fathers or with our sons such that we can sit them down, beautifully tell them, look my son, make sure that you don't associate partners with Allah. Do you have a relationship with your children? The problem is no father comes in the home like a lion, roaring. Everyone runs away. Why? Daddy's home. Astaghfirullah. Change that. Change that. Wallahi. Come home with a smile. They look at you. They must hug you. They must embrace you. Wallahi. Tight. You tell them, I love you, my son. They need to hear this. Some people think when you are a good Muslim, you cannot say, I love you. Those words are haram. Where? Show me. Where are they haram? Where? Some people say it with tajweed, I love you. Have you heard that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. The hadith says when you love someone for the sake of Allah, you tell them I love you for the sake of Allah. That is the hadith. So to tell your children I love you, wallahi, you will get a big reward. It is reassuring. Many children write to us saying, my father doesn't love me, my mother doesn't care. Why? Are you a Muslim? Allah blessed you with children. And you are saying, there is no relationship between me and my children? How? Please, my brothers and sisters, develop it. Learn from Luqman. He could sit with his sons or with his son and talk to him openly about matters. Today there is a problem of pornography. Do you agree? Very big problem because it's on your phone. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, if it is on your phone, delete it today. Delete it. For the sake of Allah. That is showing gratitude to Allah. Ya Allah, I heard a talk in this central masjid in Kumasi, and I was told to delete it, and I will delete it for your sake. It's gone. Wallahi. Don't be ashamed. Today is a day, the one who is ashamed will be Shaytan himself. He's the only one who will be ashamed. I was saying there is a problem of pornography. How many parents can talk to their children about pornography? The problem is parents themselves are involved in pornography. That is a problem. It's a reality. So that's why we can't even talk. Because your son has already seen what's in your phone. Your daughter has seen what's on your phone. It could not have been more embarrassing, but for you it's nothing. For you it's nothing. You lie. Oh, that was just a message from someone. I don't know who sent it to me. Stop giving excuses. Delete it. Say astaghfirullah, a'udhu billah. You want to protect yourself and your offspring? Cut out that pornography. Chop it off. We don't need it. It will not bring about happiness. It makes you disrespect your wife and your husband and the opposite sex. It makes you start becoming an animal in your head. Your peace is gone because you are watching things that are dirty. You start looking at animals in a dirty way because your mind is dirty. No peace, no more peace. If you want to take someone's peace away within 1 minute, they just need to witness a pornographic clip. Their peace is gone. It's gone. Seek Allah's forgiveness. May Allah forgive us all. Seek Allah's forgiveness. It is an age where the mind is being tampered with. People are becoming such that they engage in sexual behavior that is unacceptable. Totally unacceptable. But who taught them? Where did they get it from? They got it from pornography on their phones. They are hooked onto it. They see things that are dirty and filthy. Yet, to fulfill intimacy with your spouse is an act of worship. Do you know that? Fi budu'i ahadikum sadaqa. The hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, to fulfill your intimacy with your spouse is a sadaqa. How can it be a dirty act? How can we start wanting to do filthy things when it is a sadaqah? It is something you will get a reward for. The Sahaba was surprised, radiallahu anhum. How can we get a reward? Ayati ahaduna shahwata. Can one of us reach his climax and he gets a reward for that? The hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was open. He says, do you see if he did it in a haram way, would he get a sin? They said, yes. Well, if he did it in a halal way, he would get a reward. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters, it's enough. We need to have a good relationship in our homes. Build your home, you will see peace. Develop your character. Speak nicely to your family members. I said, when you go home, it should not be a cat and mouse story. It should be a loving story. When you die, your children can say, my mother, my father, they were the best of people. Allah irhamhuma kama rabbawna aw kama rabbayani sighara. Sighira. Allahu Akbar. You know the dua that Allah makes mention of in Surah Al-Kahf. Wa qul rabbi irhamhuma kama rabbayani sighira. Oh Allah, oh Allah, have mercy on them the same way they brought me. They are the ones who brought me up. Have mercy on them. Subhanallah. So Luqman alayhi salam says to his son, the first thing. What is the first point? Allah could have mentioned so many points, but he started off, Ya bunayya la tushrik billahi. Oh my son, do not engage in shirk. Shirk. Shirk is a word. You must never get tired of listening to it. When you hear the word shirk, you must thank Allah. Someone is warning you about something that Allah has warned you in the biggest way about. Don't associate partners with Allah. Worship Allah alone. That is the difference between Islam and the other faiths. I give you an example. In Islam, when someone comes to you with a powerful message, do you worship the person who was carrying the message, or do you worship the owner of that message, who is Allah? You worship Allah. Myself, I came to you. I cannot forgive your sins. You do not confess your sins to me. I am a mortal just like you. I am a person who needs forgiveness just like you. I am a man just like you. So you cannot say, forgive me. You cannot come to me and seek or try to confess your sins. Who am I? Your confession is made to the one who made you alone in the darkest hour of the night or at any time of the day or night. You confess to Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. He will forgive you. No one else. No other creature of Allah
deserves that you confess to them. Not at all. Can I forgive you? No. Not for a sin you committed between yourself and Allah. No, you will go to Allah to seek forgiveness. Yes, if you have wronged a human being, you stole his wealth, you deceived him, for example, you were backbiting about him, then you can seek forgiveness from that particular person for the sin you committed against them. Remember this. La tushrik billahi. Don't associate partners with Allah. I was in Accra last night, and the excitement in the crowd was such that when I entered the hall, they began to do takbir and various other sounds so loud that I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed because wallahi, I'm just a human being. I am a human being, wallahi. I don't deserve that. I don't at all deserve even a fraction of that. It's the message that is powerful. It is the Quran. I tell you a fact. If the message I was carrying was not from Qala Allahu wa Qala Rasulu, you would not know me. Do you know that? If the message I am carrying was not from Allah and His Messenger, you would not know me. There are millions of other people you don't know, I don't know, we don't know, because there is no common factor. You know me and I know you because of Allah. That's all. Not because of me. Subhanallah. So be careful. When you honor people, do not let that honor or respect become an act of worship. Remember that. We will honor our ulama. We will respect our scholars. We will benefit from our leaders, definitely. But worship is owed to Allah. Remember that. Ya bunayya la tushrik billahi. Oh my son, you want peace? Don't engage in shirk. Inna shirka la dhulmun azim. Shirk is indeed the worst type, the greatest type of oppression. You have done wrong. In the Arabic language, when you speak about dhulm, linguistically, it means وَضْعُ الشَّيْءِ فِي غَيْرِ مَحَلِّهِ. To put something in a place that it does not belong. To put an act of worship in a place that it does not belong. Be careful. You want peace? You will be at peace by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On condition that you worship Him alone. And in order to worship Allah alone, you and I know that Allah sent messengers to show us how He wants to be worshipped. Allah sent messengers to us to show us how He wants to be worshipped. So the messengers came one after the other. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا تَتْرَى. Then we sent our messengers one after the other. One after the other. Many messengers. We don't even know the number. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the final messenger, he came to this ummah to teach us how Allah wants to be worshipped. So when you worship Allah, make sure you are doing it according to the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's all. That's all. I cannot choose to worship Allah according to my head. For example, I think I love Allah a lot, so I look up in the sky and I start waving my hand. Is that worship? That's not worship. People will look at me and they will take me to the mental hospital. Right? I don't think you have one in Kumasi because all the people here are intelligent, mashallah. May Allah bless you. So this is called achieving inner peace, the first step. Subhanallah. Worship Allah alone. Ya bunayya la tushrik billah. Inna shirka la dhulmun azim. After that, after Allah speaks about worshipping Him alone, do you know what He says?
وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَى أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا وَاتَّبِعْ سَبِيلَ مَنْ أَنَابَ إِلَيْهِ.
Allahu Akbar. Allah says, and Allah has enjoined upon you to be kind and dutiful to your parents. After Allah speaks about worshipping Himself, He talks about kindness to parents. Be kind to your parents. Why?
Let me explain why. Who created you? Allah. Who did He choose to bring you onto the earth? Via your parents. Who chose your parents? Allah. Did you choose your parents? No. If we had a choice, every one of us would want to be born somewhere else, somewhere. Allah says, no, I know what is best for you. I know what is part of your test. You will have certain parents. The parents are a test for you, and you are a test for the parents. The parents are a test for you because you have no choice. Those are your parents. They might be bad people sometimes. They might instruct you to do that which is haram sometimes. Don't follow that. You follow that which is correct and upright. If they tell you to do something evil or to commit a crime, you will not commit a crime. Simple. And you are a test for your parents because as you grow up, your parents need to release. They need to release by the will of Allah. What does that mean? When it comes to marriage, for example, they need to get you married not according to their whims and fancies, but according to what Allah has asked them to do. That's your test. My dear parents, when you are getting your children married, it is a very big test for you. What is the test? Allah is watching to see, do you allow them to get married where Allah has allowed them to marry, or do you have your own tribalism, nepotism, racism, and all the other wrong isms that are there? If that is the case, you have failed. It's a reality. Many of our children are suffering because of parents who do not follow Islam when it comes to marriage. And they think it is Islam. They blame Islam in order to block a marriage that is halal. It's permissible. My brothers and sisters, you want to protect your offspring and progeny from committing adultery and fornication. You need to allow and facilitate and make easy the marriage. The more marriage becomes difficult, the easier haram becomes and zina. You are making one difficult, the other one becomes easy. You make nikah easy. Who wants to commit adultery? No one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah guide us and open our doors. We are talking about peace. This is how you achieve peace. Respect your parents and fulfill their rights. Respect your children and fulfill their rights. It is not one way. Many times we only talk to the crowd, oh, your parents, your parents, your parents. But we forget to say, my dear parents, your children, your children, your children. It is two-way traffic, not one. We don't achieve peace because the man is a tyrant in the home. He wants to control himself, his sons, his daughters, his sons-in-law, his daughters-in-law, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren. Everyone, every single decision must happen according to him. Why? He has money. He's a big man. How? How? The wife of your son is not under your control. She is under the control of your son. Meaning their relationship is between them. She will be kind to you as a father of her husband or a mother of her husband. You cannot control the whole home. Otherwise, the peace we are talking about today will leave your house. You will never see peace. Why? You want to control everyone. You need to know where Allah told you to stop, you stop. Now the territory is someone else's. Imagine the president of another country coming to this country and he wants to rule here. There will be war. That's what we are doing in our houses. Your jurisdiction, you have crossed it. Why? Don't cross it. Give them their freedom. Yes, you can guide them. You can advise them. The president of one country can advise the president of another country. No harm. They will welcome the advice. They create a block of many countries together. They call it ECOWAS. Have you heard that? Why? Together they want to see how they can benefit each other. It's good. But nobody can say, right, I'm ruling your country from tomorrow. No, not at all. Not at all. We are doing that in our houses. Don't. My mothers, my fathers, remember, your children are married. Respect those who are your daughters-in-law and sons-in-law. Respect them. Don't expect too much. Respect them. Speak kindly to them. Speak good about them to other people. Not when we leave home, hey, my daughter-in-law is very lazy. Very lazy. Why do you have to say that? There will be no peace. You are going to take away the peace from your heart and the hearts of others. They will live with you, but every day they will say, when someone says, Allah yutawwil umrah, you know what that means? May Allah give them a long life. They will say, La. Oh Allah, take this person away ASAP. As soon, 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 soon. Did you hear the echo? As soon as possible. Why? Why do I want people making dua that I die? Why? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So this is Luqman. Look what we learned from him. We learned a relationship between parents and children. And on top of that, the issue of shirk. And on top of that, the issue of parents and children. Respect them. The verses I read, they say, if your parents are not Muslim and they are asking you to associate partners with Allah, then that particular instruction, you don't follow it. But you keep on living with them with kindness and goodness. Just excuse them. Imagine. That shows you the relationship we should be having with the kuffar, with the disbelievers. What is it? We have a point beyond which they will worship something, we will worship something else. We will, subhanallah, not be forced to worship anything besides Allah. We excuse ourselves, but we will still fulfill their rights. We will still fulfill their rights, and we will still continue in a beautiful way. Subhanallah. You see, they said 5 minutes. But you are my witness at the beginning when I asked the question, what did they say? Unlimited. It reminds me of the mobile network. When the data, they say it's unlimited, and after 200 MB, they want to stop your phone. No, 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 my brother. This was supposed to be 10 gigabytes one time. Inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Do you allow me to go above the 5 minutes? Did you hear that? I don't know whether I heard yes or no. Subhanallah. MashaAllah. Okay, we'll end in 5 minutes, inshallah. So, my brothers and sisters, let's understand something. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter makes mention of Luqman al-Hakim's advice to his son regarding salah, the prayer. Ya bunayya aqimis salata wa'mur bil ma'rufi wanha 'anil munkar. Oh my son, fulfill and establish your prayer. If you want peace, establish your prayer. Find yourself in the masjid. Fulfill the salah. Fulfill it 5 times a day in our case. Because our sharia is the sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fulfill this and you will find peace. If you don't have peace, you are missing out on your salah. You want peace? Forget about materialism. To have the latest mobile phone will not make you happy. To have the latest of this and that will not make you happy. That is temporary. It comes with its own problems. It comes with its own difficulties. It comes with its own challenges. But to have Allah on your side, that is what will make you happy. Fulfill your salah. Fulfill it in a beautiful way. In a way that you consider it an honor to fulfill. Then you will get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And oh my son, encourage people to do good and discourage them from bad. I think many of us, we've stopped doing that. Encourage people to do good. You see someone, usika bitaqwallahi. I ask you to be conscious of Allah. My brother, don't do this. My sister, don't do that. You know what happens today? When we say, my sister, please don't do this. You are judging me. You are judging me. Stop being judgmental. Have you heard that? Yes. There is a difference between advice and judging. I didn't judge you. If I judge you, I would have said, my sister, you are going to jail for 2 weeks. That is a judgment. I didn't say that. My sister, you are going to the fire. That is a judgment. I didn't judge you. But am I not allowed to say, my sister, please don't do this. It's not good for you. That's not judging. That is advice. That is beautiful. That is a sunnah. That is what Allah asks you to do. Amr bin ma'ruf. To ask people to do good. Wa nahi anil munkar. Discourage people from bad. So inshallah, we will make sure that we don't feel bad when someone encourages us to do good and discourages us from bad, and we will also do likewise to the rest of the people as best as possible. But do it with wisdom, with tact. You see someone smoking, you don't go and punch him. No, you tell him, my brother, you know what, cigarettes are bad for you. It's better you give up the habit. You see what the box says? Cigarettes kill. Cigarettes kill. You know, I was at an airport recently and I saw something. It was a Muslim country. At the duty free, I saw so many cigarettes. And it said there, smoking harms. Smoking harms. So, when I was passing quickly, I thought it said smoking haram. I thought it said smoking haram. And I looked twice and I said, no, it says harms. Then I thought to myself, look, the word haram and harm, they are very close, right or wrong. The difference is 1A. Because what is haram? Harms. Did you hear that? And what harms is haram. Same thing. Subhanallah. Have you thought of that? I didn't think of it up to last week. Amazing. So now, when there are cigarettes, it says smoking harms. You need to know it also means smoking haram. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide those who have that bad habit to quit it. Say ameen.
Ameen.
Ameen. That ameen was very loud. It means there are very few smokers in Kumasi. Am I right? You see, I know it because when the smokers are in front of you, they don't say ameen quickly. They are quiet. When you say may Allah help you to leave it, they just say So my brothers and sisters, remember this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, and inshallah I will end, no problem inshallah, by the will of Allah. I have been speaking for 56 minutes. So according to my clock, I have 4 minutes remaining. So Allah says, regarding what Luqman al-Hakim told his son, Allah says, Ya bunayya, innaha in takum mithqala habbatin min khardal, fatakun fi sakhratin, أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله إن الله لطيف خبير. He is showing his son, oh my son, no matter how small, no matter even if it is the size of a mustard seed, weight, worth of a deed, Allah will bring it forth. Even if it is under the rocks, no matter where it is, you cannot hide from Allah. What is this teaching? He is teaching his son, you are answerable to Allah. Everything you do, you are accountable to Allah. Nothing can hide from Allah. You have to answer to Allah. Whatever you've done, Allah will take a record. He knows and He will ask you. So I have done things I might be embarrassed about. You have done things you might be embarrassed about. What is the way forward? The way forward is seek Allah's forgiveness. It is wiped out. Allahu Akbar. Did you hear that? If you are embarrassed about something you did, say, oh Allah, forgive me. I admit my sin. I will not do it again. And I regret it. Allah says, I have forgiven you. Your sin is wiped out. Forget about it. It's gone. It's over. Start a new leaf. Don't do it again. Carry on. Simple as that. So Allah is teaching us through the story of Luqman al-Hakim to say, Allah knows everything no matter where it happens. And the last part that I want to mention is character and conduct. Ya Bunay, oh my beautiful son. You know the word used is Bunay. Bunay is a sweet term. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the father tells his son, وَلَا تُصَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. Do not turn your cheek in arrogance against people. You know, you turn your cheek and you want to walk like you are higher than everyone else. No. You are just like everyone else. You are just like everyone else. Be humble. Speak about character again. Notice. And when you walk, walk with humility. Don't walk with haughtiness. No, walk with humility and Allah will bless you. And then when you speak, waghdud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the eyes and the voice. When you speak, don't scream and yell in a way that no one can understand what you are saying. You know, when something bad happens, a lot of the times people start screaming. They scream and you don't know what happened. Ah, they are running. Hey, what happened? Ah, and they are running. But what happened? Ah, come on, please tell me what happened. So Allah says, speak, say something. There is no point in yelling in such a way. Allah says, إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَصَوْتُ الْحَمِيرِ. The worst sound is the sound of a braying donkey. When a donkey brays, do you know what he says? No. When the donkey makes the noise, do you say, wa alaykum as-salam? Not at all. Because you don't even know what has been said. May Allah bless you all, my brothers and sisters. My time is up. I've spoken exactly for 1 hour. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.